Please welcome Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of the Libra Group, George M. Logothetis.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Thank you for being part of today. For supporting a cause I'm immensely proud to be involved with. With the leadership and staff who are all under the age of 30, Concordia is a youthful organization armed with idealism, yet grounded by realism. Youth empowerment personified. Now, we're gathered here today as leaders due to the vision and brilliance of two young men, Nick and Matt. And I salute you both and your team for what you have managed to accomplish. There is no shortage of leadership in this room here today. But why does it matter? Leadership is a rare attribute, hard to find, and not always demanded. But leadership does indeed matter deeply. And it matters most when the stakes are highest. There are two circumstances when, without leadership, one is completely lost. First, when you have a great and challenging enterprise to build, when you are creating something great, it could be a country, a city, a family, a company. And second, when the storm hits. It is at these times that you find out if you are a leader or not. You may spend decades preparing, or it may happen on your first day. So, what does leadership look like? It must be authentic, real. You cannot fake it. But because every leader is different, it is also personal. And as individuals, we have to find our own way to leadership. For me, I was inextricably shaped by taking over the running of a family business when I was just 19. So when I talk about leadership, I can only tell you my truth. And you, of course, will have your own. Conviction and belief are the indefatigable allies of leadership. Without belief, you cannot lead. But I would also add how crucial it is during periods of extreme crisis to be able to manufacture belief, to create confidence, to keep the wheels of belief oiled amongst those who are being led, to avoid at all costs being bitten by the wasp of woe. Not easy on many levels, but necessary to sail through the storm. Sailors have to have absolute belief in their captain. How many times did Columbus have to manufacture confidence to his men? Or Churchill to his nation in 1940? Or did Roosevelt have to be a factory of optimism to his people during the Great Depression? They all had to adjust the levers of realism and idealism appropriately and wisely, and on occasion, be unrealistic. Yes, unrealistic. A strange word, perhaps, to use in this context, but one that I believe the great men and women of the past have had to consciously sprinkle during periods of extreme duress and danger. realism versus idealism. If Churchill was realistic in May 1940, he would have retired. If Kennedy had been unrealistic in October 1962, well, there's a chance that we wouldn't be here today. So there's a time for both as a leader. They are both very important levers of leadership. When the storm hits, do you use it as an excuse to complain or an opportunity to be creative? Again, easier said than done, of course. But perhaps we should have the presence of mind to see suffering as a bridge to wisdom. Now, I also want to talk about dignified leadership. Dignity. A word which is not often used, but a powerful and noble one. So what is dignified leadership? Well, it is keeping one's moral compass pointing steady and true, not allowing it to be bent by bitter forces or being tempted to succumb to cynicism. It is giving more than you take and contributing more than you complain. It is maintaining an air of possibility when confronted with incessant and suffocating impossibility. It is seeing failure as a necessary cog in the wheel of progress and confronting it, not cowering from it. It is tapping into that moral authority which enables and encourages people to follow without being asked. That leadership is also about compromise. If we cannot compromise or are unable to adjust our understanding of others to see things through the lens of someone other than ourselves, we shall hit walls. For we all tend to see life through our own eyes and through our own set of expectations. But we need to empathize, compromise, as well as keep our fears in check. A bit of fear is not a bad thing, but a lot of fear is not a good thing. Now, Concordia's core mission aims to bring together public, private sector leaders to discuss and build opportunities to confront global challenges. The logic is simple. Business and the market are the best mechanism for the creation of private value, which in turn creates social value. And government and the nonprofits provide the way to create public value, which in turn creates social value. So we can combine to do things together that none of us could do separately. Great things. Some of the greatest human achievements came from such partnerships. This is, after all, how the internet was developed and commercialized. So this is why Concordia is such an important institution in the making. It brings us together. Government, business, nonprofits. In the same way that empowering young people is a conduit for them to mature, Concordia's mission is a conduit for improving the world through conscious collaboration. Now, we as a group are so vested because we feel an acute social conscience. It was not so long ago that we were underdogs in our community. The leadership of Libra is populated with dozens of ex-underdogs. It may not appear that way today, but it is the truth. and I have seen firsthand on numerous occasions the benefits of such partnerships to our group, to society, to governments, and nonprofits alike. Be it leasing helicopters worldwide for search and rescue, partnering with the White House on their My Brother's Keeper initiative, and seeing young interns stand taller and taller as their internships progress, or partnering with governments around the world on renewable energy projects. I have seen firsthand the power of collaboration, the value of partnerships, the need for companies to bridge and link the social, political, and business world together as one. We at Libra strongly believe that wisely empowering people with leadership is far wiser to the disempowerment that emanates from over-control. So, ladies and gentlemen, today we will hear from some great leaders on some vibrant and innovative partnerships. They will show us what is possible. Do we then do what we can to make that possibility into probability? Do we then give more than we take? Do we then place duty above desire? I say yes. And I say that together, we can dare to be great. Thank you for being here. Thank you for supporting Concordia. Thank you for being leaders yourselves. And I wish you all a great day. Thank you.